Welcome those who have joined us on live stream also. We do appreciate your fellowship and thank God for the means that he has created for us to do things like this.
Amen.
We're going to be in the Gospel of Luke tonight, the fourth chapter. And we'll be looking at Christ's message to his hometown synagogue. Quite a wonderful text of scripture. It's Luke 4, verses 14 through 30. As you know, on these Friday meetings, we have an overview type of approach to the text versus a verse by verse, which we do and we often do. Luke 4:14. Jesus has just been, Luke's record has just had Jesus tempted by the devil for 40 days.
Yeah.
And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit unto Galilee. And there went out a fame of him through all the region round about. And he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. And he came to Nazareth, where he'd been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." And he closed the book, and he gave it again to the minister and sat down. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began to say unto them, "This day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears." And all bear him witness and wondered at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, "Is not this Joseph's son?" And he said unto them, "Ye will surely say to me this proverb, 'Physician, heal thyself.' Whatsoever we have heard done in Capernaum, do also here in thy country." And he said, "Verily I say unto you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. But I tell you of a truth, many widows were in Israel in the days of Elias, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, when great famine was throughout all the land. But unto none of them was Elias sent, save unto Sarepta, a city in Sidon, unto a woman that was a widow. And many lepers were in Israel in the time of Eliseus, the prophet, and none of them was cleansed, and none of them was cleansed, saving Naaman the Syrian. And all they in the synagogue, when they heard these words, were filled with wrath, and rose up and thrust him out of the city and led him under the brow of the hill whereon their city was built, that they might cast him down headlong. But he, passing through the midst of them, went his way."
Amen.
Just another event in the days of the Lord. Now, I want to draw attention as we begin here to the frequency of the mentionings of deity in this text. It contains 16 verses. Now, the text is about the work of God, first of all, and particularly the one sent by God. And there are here 30 references to deity. In the Gospel of Luke itself, there are a great number of references. I list them here, 98 to Jesus and 13 to Christ and so forth. 366, he, which refers to deity. 257, him, which refers to deity. 104, him, which refers to deity. His, which refers to deity. And I want to make a comment now on pronouns. When pronouns are used, they're in reference to someone that's been, the emphasis has been placed on somebody. So instead of mentioning the name all the time, you say he, him, his, you know, but it tells you who, it's emphasizing somebody. So grammatically, the heavy use of pronouns indicates the personality, particular personality that's been identified. And that's, you see how many pronouns there's. There's over 600, your text says. Actually, it's 727. 727 references to deity by pronoun, which means everybody knows who the pronoun's talking about. It says he. Nobody says, well, who's the he? Everybody knows. Everybody knew who the he is. The him, they all knew who him was. I always like to capitalize him anyway. Every time I mention deity, I capitalize it every time. But see, in today's preaching, you wouldn't know who they're talking about. They say him, his. You have to come, well, who are you talking about? See? And sometimes it may be the mayor or somebody. The emphasis of Scripture is Christ. And this just kind of accents it for us. Mark refers to the record of Jesus' birth and ministry as the beginning of the gospel of Christ. So this, when you have an account of Christ, that's the beginning of the gospel. The gospels don't tell you what Jesus achieved. They just tell you what he did. That was the beginning. See, what came for what Jesus did. That's what the gospel is. The beginning of the gospel. So these accounts are the first chapter, you might say, of the gospel. And in the Gospels, you have like the miracles Jesus performed, which confirmed his deity. You have the teaching of Jesus, which confirmed his wisdom and knowledge of God. You have the death of Jesus, which affirmed the purpose of God. You have the resurrection of Jesus, that confirms the Son of God. Jesus was the Son of God with power. You have the ascension of Jesus, which confirms that Jesus is building his church from heaven and bringing many sons to glory from heaven. See, so that's the beginning of the gospel. See, the gospel hasn't really been preached till you take it from the beginning and you show what's... See, some people think the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, that's the sum of the gospel. No, it's not the sum, it's an outline of the gospel. It's an outline of the gospel. The epistles actually are a proclamation of the gospel.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And the conclusions you reach from it is because of the gospel. That's why these admonitions are given to various believers. And it's foolish to think that Christ died, was buried, rose, ascended to heaven, seated at the right hand of God, so people could live the way they want to live. I mean, this is an absurd conclusion, but most people, this is how they live.
Yeah. Ago, you mentioned to me this fact of the implications of the gospel. That's a very provocative thought, because you can look at your own, what your mainstream of what you've been preaching or what you've been saying, and is it the implications? Because that's where the power is.
That's right. See, a flashlight casts light. The implications are what it illuminates. And there's not much preaching. Now listen, there's not much preaching like this. And even historically, there hasn't been much preaching like this. People that preached like this were like leaders, pioneers. They were a special kind of people that preached this way. And they were noted for restoring and reformation and things like this that had focused preaching and told you what it meant.
Yeah, yeah. Amen.
If Christ died for sin, what are you? Why are you dominated by it? See? If justification is real, why are you living with the weight of guilt? See?
Yeah.
It's the implications of it. Experience of many contemporary believers is it's taken some time for them to realize the potency of the gospel. It's not because the gospel's hard to... That's not why it is. It's because of the way teaching has been done and the way preaching's been done, so that it's left people with the looking at the wrong thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I come from a background where after all the preaching was done, you were looking at the church.
That's
what the preacher was calculated to do.
Right.
So he said, we're trying to get the church restored like it used to be. But they weren't preaching like they used to preach. The modern tendency is to take men from their troubles to Jesus. Almost everybody preaches this way. From their troubles to Jesus. Jesus can help you with your troubles. But that's not how Jesus is presented in the scripture, as our text is going to show. He didn't say a word about marital or family matters. Other than he might divide the family. He weren't told people about that. The practice of Christian leaders involving themselves in the affairs of other men. See, this is not right. This is intruding into other people's business. A meddler in other people's affairs. It's not in your business how other people live. Only if they violate the will of God. Then it's your business to tell them what God has particularly said about his people. If you have to continually tell people how they got to raise their kids and how they have to behave toward one another, if this is like a continual emphasis, there's a real major problem exists. It's not a minor thing. And having a long course on how to do these things, this may have some benefit, but the real problem isn't being addressed. The people aren't living with God in mind. That's what the problem is. And the gospel, that's what it assists you in doing. To assist you in living with God in mind. The truth of the matter is that newness of life and the new man, where newness of life is lived, coupled with faith, lead a person in how to live. That's how it works. And there are a few things God has said along the way to help you kind of get your bearings about these things, but that's the truth of the matter. That the truth of God, the truth of the gospel, coupled with faith, will direct a person in how to live. That's why Jesus said, you seek first. You shouldn't even emphasize, even if you live in a poverty-stricken area, your emphasis should not be feeding the poor. Even if you're living in a poverty-stricken area, because the poor, the poor are told, stop thinking about what you're going to eat. Who do you think was told that? There's no need to tell that to the rich. It's the poor we're told that. God feeds birds. You think he's going to neglect you? See? That's a completely different approach.
Amen.
Jesus didn't set up a soup kitchen, and I'm not against him. Don't get me wrong, I'm not against him. I'm just saying the Red Cross does it too. Jesus taught that instead of focusing on such matters, now we're not talking about neglecting such matters, we're talking about focusing on such matters, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these matters will be addressed. There'll be all these things will be added to you. So you want the necessities of life to be additions, which means something else comes first. So the proper focus of life is important. We are taught now. whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. That's a mandate from heaven. Now, this is how a person's supposed to live. If they're not living that way, then that's got to be addressed. Uh-huh. Nobody's going to get anywhere until that's done.
Amen.
Your prayers aren't going to be answered, and God strengthen you and make you happy and joyful till that's done.
Yeah.
When that's done, then Jesus goes to work. And whether you eat or whether you drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Don't do it to please your children or please your neighbors or please your parents. Do it to please God.
Yeah. Amen.
And you'd be surprised how young you can be and be conscious about pleasing God.
Yes.
Uh-huh. So you teach your children that. Teach them, please God.
Mm-hmm.
Even when I'm not around. Now, those who omit the kind of admonitions like seek first the kingdom, whatever you do, do all in the name of the Lord, those who omit that have complicated the lives of others. They're offering a substitute for Jesus. Now, a lot of preaching and a lot of ministries, it might offend some people, I know this, but this is still the truth. They're offered a substitute for Jesus. Jesus addresses the need of the poor and the rich and everybody in between. You're complete in Christ, so woe be to people that are offering substitutes. Now, Jesus, he's going to tell us, he's not going to offer a substitute. He's going to say, if you want something from God, I'm the dispenser.
Yeah, amen.
If you want your life to be corrected, I'm the one. That's what he's going to announce. Now, our text says he returned in the power. Now, I remember he'd been fasting for 40 days and 40 nights and however long those three temptations lasted on top of that. So under normal circumstances, this would have weakened us. But he didn't return weakened. He returned in the power of the Spirit. Most versions read that way, in the power of the Spirit. Some versions read, filled with the Spirit's power, by the power of the Holy Spirit, or full of the Holy Spirit and power. Now, what I want to draw attention to here is there's a realm that is a domain that is ruled by the Holy Spirit. And a person who's filled with the Spirit, they're in that realm, which is within the world. That realm is there. Some people think of the world, and you got to get out of the world to get into the realm. Well, there's a sense in which that's true. But the truth is, the realm is in this realm. The world is a domain. When you get in this domain, you'll be filled with the Spirit, because this is his domain. Jesus was filled without measure because his work required it, and that's the sort of person he was. A domain is thoroughly ruled by the Spirit. Now, I want to emphasize this. There's a domain that's completely ruled by the Spirit. If you can walk in the Spirit, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. I mean, that's...
Amen.
That's the truth of the case. The will of God is wrought in this domain. So here's where Jesus comes. He's in the world, but he comes back from fasting 40 days and 40 nights. And on top of that, he was tempted all through those 40 days. And on top of that, he had some extraordinary temptations after it. And he comes back full of the Spirit. Now, there's some statements made about this realm that he was in, which was the reason why he was full of the Spirit. Ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be the Spirit of God dwell in you. See? The Spirit of God has taken up residence in you, and he's not like a visitor sitting on the side somewhere or in a back room. If this is how it is, you're in the Spirit.
Yeah.
The Spirit's in you, but see, if you're in the Spirit.
That's right.
And if anyone doesn't have the Spirit of Christ, he's not in Christ. He's not a Christian. He's not saved. He's not justified. He's not accepted by God.
Yeah.
This I say, walk in the Spirit, ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Yeah. You won't.
That's right.
It isn't that you might not,
uh-huh,
or occasionally you may, but you will not.
Yes. Amen.
If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. If the Spirit is what made us alive, why are we walking in any other realm? Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. See, pray in the Spirit. Don't pray with your mind meandering around to see how many things you can talk about. Pray in the Spirit. There's even love in the Spirit, Colossians 1:8. John said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Look what he got. So being in the Spirit is often contrasted with being in the flesh. It's a contrast. And there is a realm of religious flesh.
Yeah, that's right.
That's really just flesh.
Yes.
God's not in it. Now, Jesus' energy, he was in the Spirit. See, his energy had not been depleted by this.
Amen.
I've talked to people, seen people that have fasted for a long period of time. So, I'm really, really weak. You know, so my word, well, you don't need to be fasting.
Yeah.
That's what happened when you fasted, then you were just not eating that. You weren't fasting, you were just not eating, that's all.
Uh-huh.
The reason he fasted, he was focused in on God. God sustains people that focus in on him.
Yeah.
So being in the realm of the Holy Spirit, full of the Spirit, he's now going to begin his ministry. He had to operate in this realm of the Spirit to even start his ministry. And start it did. After he'd come out of those waters and God had pronounced who he was, there went out a fame of him all the region round about. He was what they were talking. They weren't talking about any special things Pilate had done, or they were talking about Christ, his fame was spread abroad.
Yeah.
See, when God sends someone, he sees to it that they're heard. This is why promoting self. This is not right.
That's right.
Sometimes I've gotten in trouble saying things like that. But feel very strongly about this.
Yeah.
I question that a person should name their ministry after themselves. Because the psalm said they call their lands after their own name. I was called down because the person said, I know so-and-so and so-and-so, they're very godly. And they said, well, that's, that's your interpretation of the matter. I stick with what I said. I don't think it's right to call your ministry after your name. Why? Because there's only one name. Gets to be honored.
Amen.
Only one. There went a fame abroad of him. Now, John the Baptist is the one that prepared the way for him. So let's note some things he said about Christ that prepared the way. The first thing he said about him, he was going to baptize with the Holy Spirit. Now, you've got religious groups to try and talk us out of this, but this is what the Scripture says. Just to say, this is the kind of baptism Jesus as compared to John. John said, I baptize with water. He'll baptize with the Holy Spirit. And he told the people he's going to thoroughly purge his floor. He's going to get rid of the people that don't belong there. And he's going to gather his wheat into his barn. Before his work is done, he will have done this.
Yes.
When Jesus finishes his work, the floor will completely be purged of all people that aren't real.
Amen. Right.
And all that are his will be gathered into the garner.
That's right.
He affirmed that Jesus was the Lamb of God that took away the sin of the world, that takes away the sin of the world. He said Jesus was preferred before, John said Jesus was preferred before me because he was before me. He said Jesus would be manifested to Israel. Luke 1:31. He declared he saw the Spirit descend from heaven and abide on Christ. These are the things John the Baptist said about Christ. He declared that a man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. He's talking about Christ. He said that he that hath the bride is the bridegroom. Talk about Christ. He said Christ had to increase. In churches, Christ has got to increase.
Yeah,
amen. See, normally the sect increases. Really, that's normally what happens. The sect increases and gains dominion, but Jesus should increase.
Yes.
The sect should say the sect's got to decrease. The institution's got to decrease,
yeah,
and Christ has got to increase. John the Baptist said that he was above all. He said that he was going to testify. Jesus was going to testify what he'd seen and heard. It was no secondhand stuff. God was going to give him the Spirit without measure. He declared the Father loved the Son and given everything into his hands. He said that he that believes on the Son has everlasting life, and whoever doesn't shall not see life. John did not say what Jesus would teach. Interesting, isn't it? He did not affirm he was going to die for the sins of the world. He said he'd take away the sins of the world, but he didn't. He didn't talk about Christ's death directly. He did not prepare people for Jesus by preaching extensively about his him as men would talk about, if men would talk about him. He said men should repent and bring forth fruit meet for repentance, and by doing this they were getting ready. For Christ. That's still what men have to do to get ready for Christ. The fame that went abroad concerning Jesus was owing to Jesus' ministry, not John's ministry. See, you got what he did is what made him famous. It's still the same way. It's still the same way. If people can't see, comprehend, understand what Jesus has done, he'll not gain fame among them. Maybe an institution will, a religious movement will, a theological position will, but Jesus won't until it's seen what he does. The fame that went abroad, now there's several mentions of this fame. For one thing, he healed the infirm. He actually did it. He didn't say, we can heal, you can be healed. He healed the people, see? You may have people, they're billed as healers, and maybe once or twice a year, someone actually sees something happen. Well, you saw every day. Jesus healed the people. Here's what the scriptures say in Matthew 4:24. And his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with divers diseases and torments, and those that were possessed with devils, and those which were lunatic, and those that had palsy, and he healed them. See, that's why his fame went. Nobody had ever done this before, not even Elijah and Elisha. Nobody had ever done this before. Not Moses. Nobody had ever, no prophet. Nobody had ever done this before. Again, it is written, the raising of Jairus' daughter, after he raised her, and the fame of thereof went abroad unto all the land. What young girl raised from the dead. Matthew 9:31, he healed two blind men. They, when they departed, spread abroad his fame in all that country. See, it's what Jesus did. If people that are in Christ would just testify what Jesus has done. See, that's not what's said. Very few people actually testifies what Jesus has done. Yeah, and them we're talking about. Matthew 14:1. At that time, Herod the Tetrarch heard of the fame of Jesus, got up into that parallel White House. Fame, he became fame because of what he did and said, see? Again, Mark 1:28, and immediately his fame spread abroad throughout all regions around about Galilee after he cast out unclean spirits. See, we got other explanations for infirmities today. We've got other explanations. They diagnose things. But see, they didn't have all that. See, how can you tell? I can't tell. But I know this thing still exists about unclean spirits. This condition still exists. And I think there's too much trying to resolve it by other means. That's my personal opinion. And again, when he healed lepers, Luke 5:15, so much the more went there a fame abroad, and great multitudes came together to hear him, and he healed them of their infirmities. See, it's what Jesus...
Yeah.
You're not going to attract people to Jesus by saying he did. Mm-hmm. Way back there, he did. Mm-hmm. You tell who he is, and it's not wrong to say this, I understand, to tell what he did. But if Jesus to gain fame, mm-hmm. it's going to be what he's done, what he's doing in that generation. That's what will cause the fame to spread. And when there's somebody, some group of really genuinely converted people that'll lay down their life for Christ, his fame will spread.
Amen.
If it's in China, they'll have a million people meeting underground. Oh, yeah. Because he did something, see?
Amen.
He actually did something. Now, it's amazing how much religion Jesus hasn't done anything. It's just a bunch of talk is all it is. So if Jesus done something in you, it ought to be displayable, first of all. It's hard to imagine that Jesus would heal somebody, but they wouldn't, a lame man, but he'd continue laying on the pallet. Jesus heals a lame man, and then they call in four people to carry him out on the stretcher. I mean, who? When Jesus heals somebody, they were healed.
Yeah, amen.
Today, when people save somebody from sin, they're saved.
Yes. Uh-huh.
They really are saved from sin.
That's right.
And the power of sin. Mm. If he really saves people, they're not walking around with their head bowed down in despair.
Mm-hmm.
See, this is what gives Jesus fame. So the fame of Jesus was owing to his uniqueness and the power of his works. That's why Mark 12:37 says the common people heard him gladly. They didn't have to sift through a bunch of other, but what if, and we may lose our position. And they didn't have to sift through all that. So it must have been very refreshing from them. From the higher perspective, he gained fame so that when he laid down his life, it could be testified and
mm-hmm.
people know who this was that laid down his life. See, you understand, for Jesus' life to count and for the gospel to have weight, people had to have been introduced to Jesus. He had to be there and gain some kind of fame and report about who he was so that when he died, then they could put things together.
Amen.
Now, his fame spread abroad, and he taught in their synagogues. Matthew says that these beginnings, Jesus went about Galilee teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, healing all manner of disease among the people. That happened after John was imprisoned.
Mm-hmm.
Our text is before. So Jesus commenced, like, right away, teaching and preaching in the synagogues. Teaching in the synagogues. That appears to be where he publicly began his public proclamation. I gave you several texts there. There's two things about Jesus that the modern age has managed to obscure. He was a teacher and a preacher. I give you the references. Oh, there's a lot about this. He was a teacher and a preacher. But there's some people been in Christ for a long, long, long time, and they don't think of Jesus as a teacher and a preacher.
Yeah.
They think of Jesus as a helper and a deliverer maybe, but some occasionally, but he's a preacher and a teacher. Jesus, that's what he is. Aspect of Jesus that's not known much today. See, Jesus said, come to me, learn from me.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, let me be your teacher.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
You want to understand? You're laboring or heavy laden. You want to understand that? You want some kind of remedy to that? You've got to come to me.
Amen.
See, I'll teach you about that. I'll show you the truth about this. And you'll find rest for your souls. You'll quit being agitated about it. See?
Yeah.
See, he's just the preacher and the teacher. He doesn't, like, speak away your troubles.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He teaches you.
Amen.
He teaches that you can say no to the devils. He teaches you that. So you can give thanks in that. He teaches you that, see?
Amen.
You can give thanks for all things. He teaches you that.
Mm-hmm.
There's a way out of this. He teaches you that. See, that's, he's a preacher and a teacher. That's what Jesus is.
Amen.
Even now, since Jesus is at the right hand of God, there's much emphasis on stress put on his teaching.
Mm-hmm.
If so be that ye have heard him, he said to the Ephesians. They'd never heard Jesus in the flesh. I mean,
mm-hmm.
If ye have heard him, and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus. Well, what does Jesus teach? He tells you in that text. It's Ephesians 4, 20 through 24. He tells you what Jesus teaches. Here it is. That you put off concerning the former conversation the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts. Quit doing that.
Yeah.
That's what put off the old man means.
Yeah.
Stop doing that.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, amen. Mm-hmm.
That stuff you have to repent of,
yeah.
Stop doing it.
Amen.
So how can I just put it off?
That's right.
And just when you make an effort to put it off,
yes.
You'll put it off just as surely as the lame man picked up his bed and walked.
Amen.
See, the effort is people are trying to control sin.
Yes.
Jesus didn't say control it.
Uh-huh.
Try and keep it to the minimum, you know. He said, put it off. It's Jesus to teach that effectively.
Uh-huh.
Here's another thing. And be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Start thinking different.
Amen.
Yeah.
Need a fresh mind on this.
Yes.
You've been walking that is for years. You've been bowed over for years. Like that woman with the bowed back. Start thinking different. Be renewed in the spirit of your mind.
Yes.
And the third thing, put on the new man.
Mm.
In other words... When it says he teaches that, it means he shows you how to do this.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
In fact, not with words. He doesn't give you words that tells you how to do it. He imparts to you that's understanding.
Uh-huh.
So all of a sudden, here's this big trouble you've got, and all of a sudden you see a gaping door you can get out of that.
Yeah.
See? Jesus teaches that way. All of a sudden he shows you the impotence of Satan in the face of no. See?
Yeah, amen. Yes.
He shows you the strength of grace.
Mm-hmm.
Grace is more powerful
mm-hmm.
than sin and Satan and guilt.
Yeah.
More powerful. He teaches you. See, Jesus is a teacher. So what shall we say when these results that he teaches aren't found? What do we say? How should we react to professing Christians who have not put off the old man? They've not been renewed in the spirit of the mind. They've not put on the new man.
Mm-hmm.
Assuming that this is a true evaluation.
Uh-huh.
Well, then Jesus hasn't taught them.
That's right. Yep.
And if Jesus hasn't taught them, they're unteachable.
Mm-hmm.
They're not in the domain. Remember, there's a domain of the Spirit. You get in the domain of the Spirit, and all this stuff begins to happen.
Mm-hmm.
You're out of the domain of the Spirit, in the flesh or in the world.
Yep.
None of this happens.
Yep.
See? So the church should be intolerant of people that persist in sin.
Amen.
They should be patient. I understand that. We should be patient.
Yes.
Teach. Be gentle and teach. But when something doesn't happen, something is fundamentally wrong.
Amen.
This is what Jesus does this.
Yes. Amen.
And Jesus is not unfaithful.
That's right.
See, for Jesus not to do this, he has to be unfaithful to the mandate that's been delivered to him. Where what Jesus said is said to teach, where that is not found or people aren't aware of it, then the Spirit's been quenched.
Yes.
Hmm?
Amen.
I mean, a person should get out of there.
Uh-huh. Amen.
Some people have been in an environment like that for years.
Uh-huh.
But the things Jesus does, they're like, when they finally see, it's like revelations. Why? Because they've never seen it happen. And the reason they didn't see it happen is Jesus wasn't there. Yeah. Or Jesus was there and he's unfaithful. And I can't accept that. So he's full of the Spirit. Fame went abroad. Now he's going to come to Nazareth, where he'd been brought up. As you know, there were those silent years from 12 to 30. Don't know anything about them. All you know is he grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man, but that was a lot. We know he was subject to Joseph and Mary. They taught him well. Mm-hmm. And we ought to mention this. These are areas where we are to ensure, as parents, mm-hmm. these take place in our children. Yeah. Whatever it takes for this to happen, you got to do it. Mm-hmm. This has got to happen. Obedience to the parents. Mm-hmm. That's got to happen. Yeah. God said this, the first commandment with a promise. Mm-hmm. Obey your parents that your days on earth may be long. It's the first commandment. And they won't teach this to them in the public school. Mm-hmm. Their friends won't teach them. You got to teach them this. Early on, young. Mm-hmm. To obey their parents so that your word is law.
That's right.
They will not break it, and if they do, penalty. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And Proverbs is full of stuff mm-hmm. like this. Growing in wisdom. Mm-hmm. It's the parents' responsibility of the parents. Mm-hmm. Picture books are nice. Up to maybe you're one and one and a half. But after a while, you got to make sure they become wise. You got to raise them up to be wise. Mm-hmm. And in stature, so that they're healthy and so forth. Mm-hmm. And grow, you got to teach them so they grow in favor with God. Mm-hmm. And so they know that's what they're doing. And more and more God's pleased with them as young people. See, you could be really young and God be pleased with you, like Samuel. You could be really young. God be pleased with you. You can be raised so when you're 3 months old and the Egyptian soldiers are around, baby doesn't cry.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Boy, some of us really should give thanks that rests aren't being made, you know, hunting for children of believers that are rests. Boy, our kids would be a big tip off right away. You got to understand these people that lived. Mm-hmm. Moses' parents had to protect that baby.
Yes, that's right.
They had to make sure they raised that baby so it kept quiet. Mm-hmm. And they did.
Yes.
See? Mm-hmm. Go in favor with God and man. Now, you've got children like Moses, you've got record of Moses, Samuel, John the Baptist, mm-hmm. Jesus, Joseph, there's another example.
Yeah.
But all of this was accomplished during those silent years you don't know about. Mm-hmm. Joseph and Mary got all of this stuff done. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, he was the Son of God. He humbled himself, remember?
Yes.
He had to learn, mm-hmm. just like we have to learn.
That's right.
The difference was he did learn. See, mm-hmm. he came to Nazareth where he was brought up.
Brother Gavin, Paul did say that Jesus learned obedience.
That's right. Mm-hmm. By the things he suffered.
Mm-hmm.
The things he suffered. That's right. Now, he came to Nazareth where he was brought up. As you know, he was called a Nazarene, mm-hmm. which the word Nazarene means alone or separated. It parallels the prophetic word branch. Mm-hmm. So Jesus came back there. He had led a separated life mm-hmm. in a city that was a bad city.
Yeah.
How about that? Mm-hmm. He led a separated life from young up in a city that was a bad city. Now the angel said, well, can't anything good come out of Nazareth? I mean, that's what kind of city it was. That these are the possibilities now we're setting before you.
Yeah.
He grew in wisdom and stature and favor with God and man, and now all of a sudden he's 30 years old, and we find out that his custom was to be in the synagogue on the Sabbath day. That was his custom. He regularly honored God by meeting on a certain day. He didn't say, well, we got to look. He was a busy man, remember. He was a busy, busy man. Jesus was going here and there, on the move all the time, but on the synagogue, on the Sabbath, he wasn't on the move. He went in the synagogue on the Sabbath day. See, the Jews regularly honored God on a particular day. See, that God raised up this people.
Yes.
Other people didn't do this, but this is what they did. They were public reading of Scripture at a certain time, in a certain place, on a certain day. They publicly read the Scriptures.
Yeah.
Preaching and teaching took place on this day. Matthew's account reads of this event, and when he was coming to his own country, he taught them in their synagogue.
Uh-huh.
Mark, he gives an account of Jesus returning to Nazareth after he raised Jairus' daughter from the dead. He says that's when it took place. Said that he went out from thence and came to his own country, and his disciples follow him. And when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogues. You see, that was Jesus' manner. I was, by the grace of God, raised up where that was the manner. On the Lord's day, we all knew what we were going to do. On the Lord's day and Wednesday, I mean, Nobody planned anything else. We knew what we were going to do. Our kids were in school. They knew what we did. On Wednesday, they knew where we'd be. They had athletic events. Our kids just weren't there, that's all. It was our custom. So I'm emphasizing this custom. See, this person might call it a routine, but it was more than a routine. Now, some people have researched the subject of the synagogues. They were a kind of a central place. It appears as though they were developed after the Babylonian captivity. At least the popularity of them was that, so that while they were in Babylon, in the cities of that empire, they built buildings where they could, on one day, they could come together. See, how about that for preserving? And they missed this practice of meeting in the synagogue. And in a synagogue, they read the Scriptures and they preached, and then there was some discussion too. Stephen, you remember, he disputed. It was an argument, it was a discussion, a back and forth type discussion. Now here's some words about Jesus. They went into Capernaum, and straightway on the Sabbath day, straight right away, he entered into the synagogue and taught. Mark 12:1-21. Mark 6:2. When the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue. Luke 6:6. It came to pass also on another Sabbath that he entered into the synagogue and taught. Luke 13:10. He was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath day. So that this is where Jesus was.
Yes.
This is where you should be. Wherever God's people are congregated. They congregated. Everybody just didn't go to their own house and have devotions at the kitchen table. And said, this isn't how they did it.
That's right.
They came together.
Amen.
And exposed themselves to the Word of God and to teaching.
Mm-hmm.
One of the prominent things, as I mentioned, at the Sabbath day, was they read from the Scripture.
Mm-hmm.
And this is mentioned by Paul and James. Both of them mention this. Paul in the synagogue of Antioch of Pisidia, he said, they that dwell in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they knew not them, nor yet the voices of the prophets, which are read every Sabbath day. So they, and apparently they read them sequentially. So that if you were there, you were every year you were exposed to all the Word of God. In the synagogue on a Sabbath day. Then James said, Moses of old time hath in every city them that preach him being read in the synagogues every Sabbath. So they read from Moses in the law every Sabbath. So every Jew was acquainted just by virtue of that.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
was acquainted with Scripture.
Yeah.
Now, there are millions of Christians that have never been exposed to the reading of all of God's Word.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I don't know of any church that I know of that if you attended there long enough, mm-hmm. you would hear all the Word of God. Because they deal on topics and
yeah.
issues. And see, but that's not what they meant. They didn't meet to discuss the issues of living under Nero.
Yeah. That's right.
Or the issues of Pilate offering some Jews on the altar that they sacrificed on. You know? Or on the issues, building issues, because a tower fell on some people. You know, they didn't. That's not why they met. What I'm pointing out is there's been a tremendous departure
yeah. Yeah.
from things God spent several hundred of years developing.
That's right.
The idea of people trusting in Him, all coming together mm-hmm. at one place, yeah. at one time, mm-hmm. and being exposed all together to the Word of God,
yes.
which all those varied perspectives. People would get different things, see different things, but see, they all were exposed
yeah.
to the Word of God. And there Jesus was in the synagogue on the Sabbath day. Mm-hmm. And they delivered to him mm-hmm. the book of the prophet Isaiah. It was technically a scroll, but a scroll is a book. A book, by definition, is something where it's written on pages.
Uh-huh.
The scroll rolls it up, a book, different pages, but it's the same thing. He delivered to him the scroll of Isaiah, which apparently was the reading of the day.
Yeah.
As I understand it, Jewish tradition says they would read sequentially through the law and through the prophets. They would read. They delivered to him the scroll of Isaiah. They had a box. They kept it in.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a minister that had charge of that. So everybody didn't have a copy of the scriptures.
Yeah.
They just have what they wrote down, maybe. You know? But they took care. Oh, I don't know how long they had this scroll, but they took care.
Yeah, yeah.
They've discovered Dead Sea Scrolls, man, for thousands of years back.
Yeah.
It's kind of a different mentality
yeah.
to preserve what comes from God,
mm-hmm.
to preserve it. So they delivered him the scroll of Isaiah. Now, the fact that the scriptures were written, this was written several hundred years before, and it had been translated, we know, at least into the Greek language, and evidence is to the Egyptian language also. But the fact of different versions and translations didn't seem to be an issue in that day, which suggests that the copies were pretty identical. Jesus didn't look at the scroll and say, what version is this? Is this the Egyptian Coptic? Or is this the original Hebrew? See, this was not the way they approached Scripture. There was such a high regard for Scripture, and anybody that copied the Scripture, these were like serious people.
Yeah, that's right.
They were afraid to write the name of God,
uh-huh.
let alone change something in Scripture.
Yeah, uh-huh.
See? So you pick up on that this today, which version you're reading from, Lord? See, you'd have to say that today, but they didn't have that kind of a problem. We understand the Septuagint version was written about 300 to 200 B.C., right in there someplace, so it had been around for quite a while. But there wasn't a problem, and I'm going to cite some reasons why there wasn't a problem. First of all, Jewish people knew the scriptures,
uh-huh.
see? So just by virtue of knowing the scripture, you can test what represents itself as scripture. I'll find this all the time. I'll pick up new versions. I'll say, hey.
Yeah.
Because I know what the Bible says.
Mm-hmm.
See? You can pick up something's wrong here.
Yeah.
The Jews knew the scripture, so that helped to protect the integrity of the scripture. And also there's a thread of reasoning in scripture that can't be interrupted.
Mm-hmm.
Only those with understanding can see it, but it ties everything together.
Mm-hmm.
It's in there, and that protects Scripture. And then there's the spiritual understanding. There's when Scripture's understood, you don't need the help of etymology. And Scriptures produce patience and comfort. So there's a result. When you are exposed to the real Word of God, there's a certain results that happen. And there's a mystery that's unfolded in Scripture that's not determined by how it's translated. So this is quite different from a scholarly approach, I know. And original language and context and so forth. Cultural setting. But these are the things that protect the Scripture. They're spiritual in nature. And the things that men cannot break. These things that I just talked about. They can't interfere with it. You'll be able to figure it out. When he opened the book. Now we understand that they didn't have divisions and punctuation and all that. That means they had to know the book. If there wasn't any punctuation or verses today, I don't even want to think about what kind of confusion would be introduced. Yeah. I thank God someone thought to do that.
Yes.
But these people, see, they were people of the book. He just unrolled the scroll till it come to the particular. He had the scroll of Isaiah. He unrolled it this is pretty well through to Isaiah. This is chapter 61. So he rolled through there till he come to this certain text. And it read, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach," so forth. Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Now, the majority of the versions read, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me." They read that way, most of them. God's Word Bible says, "The Spirit of the Lord is with me." Well, it's kind of same thing, because Spirit of the Lord on you and with you, that is technically the same thing. He isn't on a person impersonally.
Yeah.
See, it's on him like a crown of authenticity is placed upon him. Now this is a statement. What statement is read here? "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he hath anointed me to." This can only be said of the incarnate Word. His ministry was thorough in this area. See, other people, is certain things they're anointed to do, but this is a thorough thing. And Jesus, he told you all in his preaching. He told you, "Look, I'm not operating on my own." Which means he didn't depend on his deity.
Yes.
And you better not depend on your sonship. You depend on the Lord.
Yeah, that's right.
You don't trust. Don't depend on the fact that you're a son of God. That's not what your faith isn't to be there. Uh-huh. Jesus would have had, if that was legitimate, Jesus would have had that kind of faith. But here's what he said. "The Son can do nothing of himself, but what he sees the Father do." See, he clarified this. That's another way of saying the Spirit of the Lord was upon him. Here's another way. "The Son can do nothing of himself, but what he doeth see the Father do." Jesus said in another place, John 5:31, "If I bear witness of myself, my witness is not true." And this thing that I'm saying came from me, discard it. Oh, what if we honor that, huh? Preacher, where'd that come from? Well, this is how I see it. Discard it.
Yeah.
"I'm not come of myself," John 7:28 says, "but he that sent me is true, whom you know not." John 8:28, "I do nothing of myself, but as my Father hath taught me." John 12:29, I have not spoken of myself, but the Father which sent me, he gave me commandment what I should say. John 14:10, "The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works." See, Isaiah said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon you," and this is what Jesus is saying. That's what he's saying here. He's saying, in order to come to earth and walk among men and be made available to men, this had to happen. I had to lay aside my status.
Uh-huh.
I had to lay it aside. When I came out, I had to be taught just like you were taught. I had to be of age before I could learn, just like you. Mm-hmm. See, Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Yeah. Now, it was necessary for the Holy Spirit to be on the incarnate Word. Mm-hmm. Then who could have managed any of us not requiring the Holy Spirit to be on us? Who could imagine such a stupid thing as that? But the people do. There are people that do imagine that. If Jesus needed the Spirit, well, certainly you do too. And because of Jesus, you can have the Holy Spirit. He hath anointed me and has set me aside. Now in Scripture, there were priests were anointed, kings were anointed, prophets were anointed, vessels were anointed, which meant they were set apart. There come a day when Jesus stopped being a carpenter.
Yeah, that's right.
That day came. Stopped. Spirit of God was upon him, anointed him. And anointed him to preach the gospel to the poor. Now the word preach the gospel, that's translated from a single word, which means to bring good news, announce glad tidings, see. Now to Adam and Eve, remember, they got a message of cursing, right?
Yeah.
This is the message Adam and Eve got, message of cursing. You see, what about the seed? That was delivered to the devil, which was a curse to him.
Yeah, that's right.
Moses, he delivered a message of requirements. The prophets, they delivered messages of judgment. Mm-hmm. But Jesus was sent to preach the gospel, good news.
Amen.
To declare, to preach means to announce what you preach has already happened.
Yeah, amen.
You don't preach what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. You prophesy what's going to happen, but you preach what's happened already. So he preached to the poor. Who are the poor? It wasn't the people that were just physically impoverished. That's not what he's talking about. Because Jesus gave it a word to the poor.
Yeah.
Word to them was that don't take thought about this. Mm-hmm. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. These were, as we understand, the poor in spirit. The people were impoverished before God. Mm-hmm. They were impoverished and they knew it. This message integrated with the message of John the forerunner. He preached that mentioned repent. Mm-hmm. See? And people repenting, they fell into this poor state where they were. No, they knew they had nothing. They're standing before God, they got nothing. And he preached good news to those kind of people.
Amen.
Poor in spirit. People had shrunk back. As soon as they were like Israel at Mount Sinai, God appeared, they shrunk back. Good news to them. That's a parallel of saying, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Come and learn from me. See, that's the kind of thing he's talking about. Adam made us poor.
That's right.
Jesus makes us rich.
Amen.
He sent me to heal the brokenhearted. He sent me. It's on a mission originated by God. Mm-hmm. To heal the brokenhearted. Now, that phrase is omitted. I list the versions, a lot of them in there. That phrase is omitted in those versions. It's included, I list the ones it's included in. Other versions read, to make well those who are brokenhearted, to heal the contrite of heart, heal the brokenhearted. These are versions that make reference to it. Heal the contrite heart, heal the broken heart, heal the ones being brokenhearted. And these other versions, they don't even mention the phrase at all. Completely omitted. I couldn't find a satisfactory explanation for that on any level. The omitted phrase is in Isaiah's prophecy. Isaiah 61:1. It's mentioned directly. Heal the brokenhearted. And all of these versions that omit it here include it there. See? So I don't care what they say about manuscripts. I don't care. These people are dishonest. If you know Isaiah said it, why do you take it out of here where it says he These kind of men are dishonest.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Those who are brokenhearted are those who are crushed before God because of what they see they are.
Yes.
Here's some expressions of it. The Lord's nigh them that are of broken heart, save such as be of a contrite spirit. See, this is what he's talking about. People that are aware of how God sees them.
Yeah.
I am feeble and sore broken. I have roared by reason of the disquietness of my heart. Psalm 38:8. Here's Psalm 51:17. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart thou wilt not despise. I guess he won't despise it.
Yeah.
Says he's been sent to heal.
Amen.
The brokenhearted. Psalm 69:20, reproach hath broken my heart. I'm full of heaviness. He healeth the broken in heart. Psalm 147:3. And sometimes there's a heart's broken because of what they see in other people. Jeremiah 29:3. Mine heart within me is broken because of the prophets. Mm-hmm. Yeah, how about that? How about that? Broken because of the prophets. Mm-hmm. Here's David, Psalm 119, 158. I beheld the transgressors and was grieved. See? Psalm 139, 21. Do not I hate them, O Lord, that hate thee, and I am grieved with those that rise up against thee. See? So they're grieved about their own transgressions. They're grieved by other people's transgressions. But see, both cases, the Lord will heal.
Yes, amen.
The broken heart. It's terrible to just go all through your life angry and grieved because of the sins of others.
Mm-hmm.
You want to be strengthened so that that's not a lingering, debilitating thing. And God himself, sometimes he's broken, you know. Here's Ezekiel 6:9. They that escape of you shall remember me among the among the nations, whither they shall be carried captives, because I'm broken. I'm broken with their whorish heart.
Mm-hmm.
See, you think about God being broken? That's how it affects God. That's how all this sin affects God.
Amen.
Don't be casual about the sin of others. Genesis 6:6. You repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart.
Yes,
there they are, see?
Right.
Judges 10:15. The children of Israel said unto the Lord, we have sinned. Do thou unto us whatsoever seemeth good unto thee. Deliver us only, we pray thee, this day. And they put the strange gods away from them and served the Lord, and his soul was grieved for the misery of Israel.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Not only grieved because they sinned, grieved because they had to repent.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
God said to Israel, 40 years was I grieved with this generation.
Yeah.
How long do you think he'd been grieved with our generation?
Yeah.
Huh? How long? How long do you think he's been grieved with our generation? Look at the stuff that's been invented and perpetrated in our generation.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
From drugs to immorality. Just look at it, what's happened. Do you think this hasn't affected God? The trouble today is it hasn't affected the church.
Yeah. Amen.
They don't grieve over this.
Yeah.
They did God to heal that too.
Yeah.
He will. To heal a broken heart, it means their sorrow is replaced by joy. And they see a different perspective. And he said, I've been anointed to preach deliverance to the captives. Not to enable deliverance for the captives, preach. Now, this is the second time preaching has been mentioned in this proclamation. Something that is preached has already been accomplished.
Yes.
Preach deliverance to the captives. How can liberty be announced to prisoners that are still in bondage? Well, allow me to touch on this. First, the oppressor is judged.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
See? Jesus destroyed him that had the power of death, that is the devil. See,
yep.
So the oppressor was judged.
Amen.
And then there's a change in the oppressed so that they obtain a status of more than conquerors.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's removal of the power of the enemy. We could translate it down this way. He took the doors off the prison.
Amen. Right.
So yes, some of these people were sitting in the cells. They weren't aware that like Samson had taken away the gates of Gaza, the doors had been taken off by Christ, but they didn't know it. So he announced deliverance. Come on, come out of there.
Yes.
You see how wrong it is, and people cook up systems of recovery. Do you see how wrong that is? Anyone who's enslaved to sin, if they believe the gospel, can get up and walk out unscathed.
Amen. Uh-huh.
The person doesn't believe that, they just as well drop the name Christian. This is what this is what Jesus is all about.
That's right.
He doesn't need a long time to enable a lame man to walk, or a blind man to see, or a deaf man to hear. Oh, the church needs to preach a gospel like that.
Yes, amen.
And the recovering of sight to the blind. He's preaching this now. He's not saying this can happen to you. He's preaching this.
That's right.
There's no justifiable reason for any person in Christ remaining spiritually blind or ignorant.
Mm-hmm.
It can't be justified. Mm-hmm. And I know people have been blind 50, 60, 70 years. They say they're Christians. I don't want anyone to even try and explain it to me. I don't want it explained. I want it resolved.
Amen.
This needs to be preached.
Amen.
The recovering of sight to the blind. The prophet said, the blind shall see out of obscurity. Yeah. See, the prophet said this is coming. The prophet said, and the eyes of them that see shall not be dim. Isaiah 35:5, then the eyes of the blind shall be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. See, so the prophets told about this day.
Yeah.
Now Jesus said, it's come now.
Yeah.
It's come now. The healing of physically blind people were a proof that Jesus could do this other. That you might know the Son of Man hath power to forgive sins, take up your bed and walk. See, the overt miracles was a way of teaching people with no understanding, you see. What I just did is impossible, but now I can do this other.
Yes.
The blind can see. Your eyes, the eyes of your understanding can be enlightened. If a person doesn't understand the things of God, they can. We announce to them, this is understandable.
Mm-hmm.
Not because we're really good preachers and we can explain it. We try and do the best we can. But Jesus has come to preach the recovery of sight to the blind. And where Jesus remains, he will do this. Now, I want to emphasize this, that Jesus, if Jesus would come to a person and stay and not recover their sight, then Jesus would have been unfaithful to his commission. See? But he's not unfaithful. In fact, he is faithful.
Amen.
He is the great faithful one.
Amen.
That's who he is. But where Jesus is not received, he will not do this work.
That's right.
And to set at liberty them that are bruised. The word bruised there, as I understand it, means that the effect of the shackles that they had is depicted in Joseph when he was in prison.
Mm-hmm.
Psalm 105:18 said of Joseph in prison, whose feet they hurt with fetters. See, that's the bruises. Yeah. That's the bruises he's talking about. The effects of sin. See, sin leaves effects,
yeah,
hurtful effects on the soul.
Yeah.
But he says, I've come to set at liberty. You not only come out of the prison, you come out without the shackles.
Yes,
you not only come out without the shackles,
uh-huh,
you come out without the bruises or the effects,
yes,
of the shackles.
Amen.
You don't have to live with a unbearable aftermath of sin.
Yeah.
There may be things, I understand, there may be things that you will recall and that you have to bear up under. I will show thee the great things thou must suffer for the namesake, but the suffering for your own sins,
mm-hmm,
you will not have to do that.
Yes, amen.
Shackles will come off,
yes,
and the bruises will go away,
mm-hmm,
and you'll be able to walk about in freedom. You don't remain enslaved to sin. See, there are people that teach. This is being taught in churches in this city.
Uh-huh.
This is being taught that there are Christians who are still enslaved to sin. They don't say enslaved to sin. They say addicted.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah. If that situation is true,
uh-huh,
then Jesus couldn't preach deliverance to the captives.
Amen.
And I preached the acceptable year of the Lord. He said, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. A time when the good things that are promised are taking place. See, the Savior, he was chosen before the foundation of the world. And those that were accepted, they were chosen before the foundation of the world. And the kingdom prepared for them was prepared before the foundation of the world. And so far as the works of salvation are concerned, the works are finished from the foundation of the world. But then there come this time when all these benefits were like released, or the storehouses were open, like Joseph's storehouses. See, there came a time when this became available to the people of God. Jesus says, that's what I'm announcing. I'm announcing that all of these good things that God promised, they're here. I'm the one that's announced them. In other words, you can get a hold of them now. See, they're within your reach now. Uh-huh. See, oh, this is good news for people to hear this. The reasons our sins are forgiven is so that the forgiven ones can gain access to what's to the storehouse. That's right. That's why you're forgiven sins. It's just not to give you relief. Uh-huh. Amen. It's to move you into the area where all the food is.
Yes.
And after he announced this, and I imagine no one ever read the scripture like Jesus did, he said, he closed the book, gave it to the minister, he sat down. That's what they did when they taught. When they sat down to teach, that meant this isn't going to be a short discourse. Why else would you sit down? If it was going to be a short, he would just remain. But he sat down. And told him, he said, he closed the book. Then it had been such a powerful reading of the text, evidently, that all the eyes of the synagogue were fastened on him. Well, they all wondered what he was going to say, because that was some good stuff he was saying there. I don't know what the scribes had taught him. But see, I don't know what the scribes had said about that text. But everybody's eyes were fastened upon him. He was the center of attention. And I'll tell you, when people know that Jesus is present, they'll pay attention.
Yes.
They may not agree with him, but they'll pay attention.
Yeah.
Jesus can't be someplace and people know he's there and him be ignored. This is the way it works. He began to say to them, since all we're just getting an introduction to what he said. He just began to say this to them. This day, this scripture is fulfilled in your ears. The stuff I said would happen, today it's happening. The things said I will do, I'll do them today. Whoever's sitting here listening wants their eyes open, it's fulfilled in your ears. See, fulfilled in your ears. The fact that you heard it means you can have it. Oh, this! I wish I could say this in a more powerful way. But if it can ever get across to you what God has promised, the things God has promised for them that love him, things God has prepared for them that love him, if it can ever get across to you what he said, the fact that you heard it means you can have it.
Amen. Yes.
If you can't hear it, well, then that's what you need to pray. Lord, open my ears.
Yes.
Open my understanding so I can see what you provided, because when you see it, you can have it.
Yes.
That's the way it is. Now, the full prophecy of Isaiah 61, I wanted to mention what he said in there, because these are promises that Jesus said he was fulfilling. He'd bring glad tidings to the meek, is how Isaiah put it. The brokenhearted would be bound up.
Yeah.
Liberty would be proclaimed to the captives. The opening of the prison announced to those who were bound. The acceptable year of the Lord announced. Then he added the day of the vengeance of God proclaimed. That'd be vengeance of God taken out upon Christ for our sin, and vengeance of God that will be taken out for those that don't accept Christ. Comfort proclaimed to all that mourn, to appoint it like an exchange program. Beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. So they would be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. The old wastes would be built. when Jesus goes to work. This is the stuff that happens. Mm-hmm. The former desolations would be raised up. Mm-hmm. The waste cities would be repaired. Mm-hmm. The desolations of many generations. Mm-hmm. Others would serve them. Mm-hmm. They would be named the priests of the Lord. Isaiah 61:6. They would be called then the ministers of our God, and they would experience everlasting joy. Now, these are the things that Isaiah said would take place when Messiah came. It's kind of a snapshot of salvation. That's what it is, a snapshot of salvation. So if people's lives, they'd been a mess of them, they'd correct them. If their life was in shambles and in waste, they'd rebuild them.
Yeah, right.
That's what it said. Amen. Of many generations. Yeah. They would recover things, been lost for many generations. Uh-huh. We'd recover them. So as you peruse this glorious announcement, you'll find it's in sharp variance to what is being preached in this day. These are set forth as kind of like goals. This can happen, but this is what happens. I want to underscore this, brethren. Mm-hmm. This is what Jesus does when he's received.
Amen.
When he's not received, he just moves on to somebody else. But these are the things he does. And we have a right to expect these things to be found.
Amen.
And people say they're aligned with Christ. And I understand there's different measures. I mean, I understand that. Mm-hmm. But in some measure, these things have to be found.
Amen. Yeah, Brother Gibbon, you know, when you already mentioned this, but when these things, when you can hear these things in the gospel, when you can discern, now you, not only are they available, but you are responsible for implementing them and taking advantage of them. Yeah. Because just hearing them isn't enough. You're going to have to take, and you're going to have to do something with the things you've heard.
Amen. That's why there's exhortation.
Yes, amen.
That's why Peter, you know, he said with many other words, he exhorted them and said, save yourself from this untoward generation. Yes. See, that was the beginning. Something was starting on Pentecost. He said, you got to do something about this today.
Amen.
We ought not to support any person or work that proceeds as though these things don't happen. And so they create a substitute. See, they create a sub. That's what these programs are. Yeah. They're a substitute for Jesus. What is there exactly in here that Jesus didn't address? What is the human need that Jesus doesn't address?
Yeah.
What is it? See, we need to press this issue.
Yeah.
What is it? Are we complete in Christ or are we not? We know that Jesus is faithful. In fact, his name is faithful. His name is faithful, and he's called a faithful witness. And he said this is what he does. The only thing standing between you and the doing of it is for you to receive him.
Yeah, amen. That's right.
Well, the people listened, and they all marveled at the gracious words. Oh, boy, those are good words, wasn't it? Oh, that was a good sermon today.
Yeah.
That was really good. They started talking about him. Wondered his gracious words. Words of the poor hearing good news and the prisoners being released. So it's just all good, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
So did they say, well, thank God the Messiah's here? No, that's not what they said.
No.
They said, isn't this Joseph's son? Was raised up among us? They knew Jesus after the flesh. Now, 2 Corinthians 4 tells us we don't know Christ after the flesh anymore. We do not know Christ after the flesh anymore. They did. They knew him after the flesh. It's not this Joseph's son. Now, among other things, this tells us that Joseph and Mary didn't tell people that Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit. They didn't tell people he was the Son of God. Neither Joseph nor Mary shared with them the personal things that were told them about Jesus. So they thought it was Joseph's son. In fact, they thought, some people said that Jesus was a Samaritan. Like he was illegal. Mm-hmm. A Samaritan had a demon. Now, to me, it would have been inappropriate for them to tell the people what the angel had told them. To begin with, the people wouldn't have believed it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
They said, come on, you committed adultery. That's why you're expected. Don't be telling us this. There's things you tell and there's things you don't tell.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
There's some personal things about salvation that you don't tell unregenerate people. And I can tell you one of them is that you've been born again. This is not intended to be told to the world.
Mm-hmm.
They don't know what it means and they won't believe you.
That's right.
See? There's some things you don't tell people.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to know this.
Yeah.
You tell them what they can know.
Yeah.
But that's all.
Mm-hmm.
You may even say to them, I'm never going to die. They don't believe you. Right? They don't believe you, even though there's a truth. There's family talk, and then there's talk to others.
Yeah, that's right.
And you have it illustrated in this right here.
Uh-huh, yes.
There's a lot of things that they could have said. Jesus, you know, Jesus is, he's never done anything wrong in our house.
Yeah.
They didn't let that. That wasn't for public use.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
That was all in the words, he sins not. You know, that was... It was all wrapped up in that.
Yeah.
So there are some things that are not intended to be spoken in public. I have access to God.
Yeah.
Well, this is the truth, you know, but this isn't something you tell the world.
Uh-huh.
How about this? As you may know, I'm being conformed to the image of God's Son. This is not the public.
Yeah.
This is not the public thing. I'm sitting together with Christ in the heavenly places. This isn't something you tell someone who's outside the family.
Mm-hmm.
I have the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
See? Well, that's enough. You can see that Jesus, he was totally free from sin, so he could say, I came down from heaven. Which one of you convinces me of sin? See, your testimony is only as strong as your life.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
Just that strong. If you make a bunch of blunders, that you don't say much.
Yeah.
Limit what you say.
Yeah, if you're going to tell people you have the Holy Spirit, you better really need to have the holy conduct to go along with it.
That's exactly right. See, Jesus, he could divulge things because nobody could put anything on him at all.
Uh-huh. Amen.
Paul, when he bore testimony, it's interesting what he said. He said to Agrippa, I wasn't disobedient to the heavenly vision. He told Agrippa what God told him to do,
uh-huh.
and then he told him, that's what I've been doing.
Yeah, uh-huh.
See, so it was something could be put
that's
to the
right,
test.
Yeah.
Now, Matthew gives his account of this, Matthew 13:54. When he was coming to his own country, he taught them in their synagogue, insomuch that they were astonished and said, whence hath this man this wisdom and these mighty works? Is not this the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary and his brethren James and Joseph and Simon and Judas and his sisters? Are they not all with us? Whence then hath this man all these things? And they were offended in him. That's Matthew. Here's Mark's account. Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and of Judah and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us? And they were offended. At him, see, so if he had just let the message drop, see, everybody would be on a high end, on a high note.
Uh-huh.
But that's not Jesus. Jesus knew the hearts of people, see.
That's, right,
that's the difference.
Uh-huh.
Jesus knew the hearts of people.
Yeah.
This is not a template you can use when you speak to people because he knew all people.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But he said to them, you will surely say, he knew what they were saying. Oh, boy, wasn't that good today? Well, I'm glad we came today.
Yeah.
Heard a good message today. Ye will surely say unto me, unto me this proverb, physician, heal thyself. Whatsoever ye have done in Capernaum, do also here in thy country.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know where this saying originated or anything like that. But what he was saying was, you will say to me, whatever you're doing everywhere else, why don't you do it in your hometown?
Mm.
That's what he was saying.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't you do it here? You're down here in Capernaum doing all kind of stuff. Why aren't you doing it here? See, that's what they were saying. Mm-hmm. All many reports concerning what he was doing elsewhere, but there weren't many reports coming over what he did there. Yeah. One of the gospel writers say that he did heal a few sick folk there. But he didn't do much. There were a lot of reports about Jesus going into Nazareth, but there wasn't a lot about what he did in Nazareth. See, that, there are not many good reports coming out of that, visit. No prophets accepted in his own country. Well, that's an accurate appraisal of history. Moses and all the prophets, they could say a hearty amen. Hearty amen to that. Matthew gives this record. They were offended in him, but Jesus said unto them, a prophet is not without honor, save in his own country and in his own house. Mm-hmm. Mark says he is in his own country and among his own kin, mm-hmm. and in his own house.
Yeah.
And then he adds, he could do no mighty work save that he laid his hand on a few sick folk and healed them. See, so. Mm-hmm. Jesus says there were a lot of widows in Israel. Mm-hmm. But God didn't come to the rescue of any of them. Mm-hmm. It was a widow in Sarepta, a city in Sidon, a Gentile widow. Mm-hmm. God sent Elijah. This account is found in 1 Kings 17. Mm-hmm. Here you have a haughty and a favored nation. Mm-hmm. A lot of widows in it.
Yeah.
And God just ignores them and goes over here to one single widow and shows favor to her. The people standing before Jesus were members of a faithless and perverse generation.
Uh-huh.
Now he said there were some lepers. There were many lepers that were in Israel, see, at the time of Elias. Many lepers were there.
Uh-huh.
They had a lot of lepers, but none of them were cleansed.
Uh-huh.
Except Naaman the Syrian.
Yeah.
The Syrian boy, he gave Israel trouble all the time. That record's found in 1 Kings 19.
Uh-huh.
A bigoted people thought they ought to be favored by God.
Yeah.
As we have signs, you know, people call by my name, humble themselves, so forth, signs all over. It's a bigoted nation wanting favor from God.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
In the meantime, there's some foreign countries
yeah.
where people are believing on Christ.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Heathen nations
yeah.
believing on Christ. In China, you got over 1 million people beaten underground. There are some people would be angry about that. Why aren't we blessed? I'll tell you why. Because
yeah.
we're a wicked, faithless generation.
Yeah.
The nation is as a whole.
Yeah.
They were filled with wrath when they heard this. They're filled with wrath. Boy, this pushed them over the edge.
Yeah.
In the synagogue service stopped right
yeah.
there. That was
right.
the end of it. Filled with wrath, and they got up.
Yeah.
Some way gathered around Jesus. Herded him off like the city was built on the brow of a hill. And this crowd pushing Jesus to this brow, they're going to push him off.
Yeah.
Hmm. On the Sabbath day,
yeah.
after a synagogue service.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. They're going to kill him.
Yeah.
Because he said somebody beside them got blessed.
Yeah. Yeah.
I can remember during my employment in a local school, I was called to account because I preached in some denominational churches. Oh, this is a big issue. I said, well, so they said, you can't do this. I said, well, I'm going to do it. Said, what I told them was, I said, you need me more than I need you, so I'm going to preach. But the only reason was because they weren't one of us.
Yeah.
See?
Uh-huh.
It's the same thing that happened here. It's the same thing
yeah.
that happened here.
Uh-huh.
And to this day, some of these things pursue me. Because how dare you tell us that an Assyrian was blessed and someone in Israel wasn't. But this was a scriptural look. This is something God did.
Amen.
There's some people that are upset if some group of Baptists or Methodists or Pentecostals, the light shines on them and it makes some people mad. Because they aren't some of us. Well, that's what happened here. And they rose up, pushed them off, but apparently Jesus, they couldn't see him. He may have blinded him somewhere or changed his form. He just walked right through the middle of them. As some versions read, he walked right through the middle of the crowd and went away. The Jerusalem Bible says, just went away, just went on to the next station. That was it. See, the truth about his hour to die hadn't come yet.
Yes, that's right.
So he just went on and went about his father's business. But this record's left us to tell us you can be exposed to a lot of Jesus and turn him down.
Yep, that's right.
These people were exposed to Jesus from the time he was 2 to the time he was 30. And he was absolutely distinctive, but they didn't see it. And no one is walking around saying, "Have you noticed how holy Jesus is?" No one was saying it, but everybody could see it. So yes, the gospel still being preached. Do well to announce these things.
Yes.
The day of salvation is here, the acceptable time. I didn't deal with that. The acceptable year. This is the time when all these promised benefits now are available.
Yes, amen.
That's the acceptable year. Now you can take hold of these things that people have been looking forward to them for centuries. Uh-huh. For centuries, people have been looking forward to these things.
Mm-hmm.
Now the time had come.
Yeah.
Tap into it. So that's what I say to you, that all these benefits that he mentioned, lay hold of them.
Amen.
Take advantage of them. They're yours. They're accessed by faith. That's how you have them. You have them by faith. You can be more than a conqueror because these things are absolutely true. Any of you have something more you'd like to add? Yes, Brother Jason.
When Jesus said this, today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing, I doubt anyone ever heard that particular interpretation of that passage. You know, it occurred to me that this text is very instructive for us to understand how to understand the Bible.
Amen.
Bible is about Jesus and the gospel. Isaiah, that passage from Isaiah, he was preaching the gospel.
That's what he was doing.
And Jesus said that passage where Isaiah was, he was prophesying the gospel.
Yeah.
And Jesus says, "I'm here to fulfill that." But that is what the scriptures are about.
Amen.
Jesus and the gospel. That's what unlocks the meaning of the entire Bible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when you plop to that 61st chapter, I think I said it was a snapshot of salvation.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
That shows you the many different facets of salvation.
Uh-huh.
And Jesus, when Jesus announced it, he was saying, it's available. You could tap into it. I brought it now within your reach.
Yeah.
See, when people are like, they don't know what the Bible means.
Yeah.
The problem isn't, that's really not the problem.
That's right, amen.
The problem has something to do with their relationship to Jesus.
That's right.
Because if you know Christ, it'll open up scriptures for you.
Amen.
Now you can read the scriptures and learn about Christ. But if you really want to understand, it's got to be from Christ. It's got to be from Him.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. All right, we'll have a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ and for this acceptable year. We thank you for such a detailed prophecy as Isaiah gave, for the announcement that the one who is speaking of has come. Father, we want to be a complement to the ministry of Jesus, to be an exhibit of the fulfillment of these things. And we ask for your grace to do so, and to do so consistently. In Jesus' name, amen.